Welcome to this presentation of the TouchFX Graphic Library solution for the STM32 MCU family. After a recall of the background of this solution, we will review the main features and the central tool offered to design a graphical user interface layout, the TouchFX Designer. Then, we will focus on the main principles of TouchFX, how the solution is structured to handle graphical user interface management in an optimized way regarding resources, thanks to the combination of an underlying design pattern and a powerful graphic engine. Regarding the background, TouchFX was invented by Mjolnir Informatics in 2009 and was then integrated into a separated structure called Dropner Graphics in 2014. It was providing, at the time and still now, a smartphone-like graphical user interface creation tool, but outside a smartphone platform. The target was embedded platforms with constrained resources in terms of CPU, memory, and power consumption, and essentially without a graphical processing unit. The TouchFX Designer, the editor itself, is in constant improvements since its first official release in 2014. So it means that more and more features and widgets are now configurable within the editor. In 2018, Dropner Graphics was acquired by STMicroelectronics. And why do we get only now a first integration of the TouchFX Designer? First of all, this means a new site location for ST in Denmark, Aarhus, the name of the city. It needs to reshape completely the graphic integration into the ST ecosystem, because the first point is that any TouchFX Designer release was tied to a Cubemx release. The tool could not evolve until a new Cubemx release was done. And it has to support all the ST development kit, so at least the graphical enabled ones. That means that the ones which has that has some hardware accelerator, such as the ChromeArt accelerator, LTDC to control the TFT LCD displays, and other JPEG codec. And we still have also to ensure the continuity of the online tools, the one that were present in the when Dropner Graphics was a separated entity, and the one that were existing already with ST online support tools. So for all these reasons, the first Xcube TouchFX release was only done in January 2020. In terms of STM32 graphic libraries, there are several solutions that take full advantage of the STM32 specificities. The STMWin solution is a contract that ST did with the Seeger company to deliver free of charge to ST customers the Seeger solution for graphic applications. This solution is now part of the legacy. It means that it is still maintained. We still give some support to customers who choose this solution, but it is not integrated as the TouchFX is in the Cubemx tool. Only some demo examples are provided in the Cube firmware supporting the STMWin solution. Embedded Wizard is another graphic library solution that supports all the STM32 specificities, but this one is not free of charge. We have to set up a financial agreement to use it. But it's still interesting because mainly of the multi-platform approach. It means that you can develop once your graphical user interface and deploy on STMCU solution, but also on the web interface and or on the PC, for example. And finally, the TouchFX solution, which is now completely part of the ST ecosystem. An overview of the TouchFX solution. So it proposes to draw basic shapes, such as lines, circles, custom shapes. It also allows to apply scaling and 3D rotation to images at real time, but still keeping a minimal memory footprint. And it also allows to create custom controls by extending or modifying existing widgets, or by combining existing control with a custom container functionality. It also includes some advanced rendering algorithm, which are in two kinds. First, an algorithm that is able to determine precisely which part of the graphical element are visible or not, and another one that is the which to determine which part of the display needs to be redrawn for a given frame. And the underlying graphic engine is optimized for a minimum CPU load and memory footprint. Of course, it also provides a full environment development, which means for the user interface editor, the designer, which includes a PC simulator and the support of several integrated development environments, the IDEs. The key features of the TouchGFX solution is that it's a full C++ framework, taking full advantages of the object-oriented approach, which allows to minimize the RAM and flash footprint through static memories allocation. It also introduces a model view presenter design pattern approach that we will see in details in a few slides, and provides a clean split between the application state, the user interface, and the hardware. And it has an interface-based flexible approach that allows to run on any STM32 MCU, even the ones that have not an integrated hardware accelerator for graphic. It means that by default, the graphic library, the TouchGFX library, is using some generic interfaces, for example, for blitting an image to another. By default, the implementation is a pure software implementation, but if the Chrome art is available on a given platform, then the implementation is replaced by calls to the Chrome art API. And the same ID comes with the RTOS support, which is not mandatory, but still the graphic library uses a specific interface that can be either implemented using a free RTOS calls for Semaphore, notably, or using a custom approach using a volatile global variable to implement a lock mechanism. The TouchGFX support provides support for several kinds of display interfaces, including DPI, DBI, and DSI, but in fact is not aware of the actual connection to this interface. All it needs is a way to refresh the display, whatever the connection is behind. We'll see that also in the HL implementation. And it supports 1 bit per pixel up to 24 bit per pixel color displays. It also supports multiple frame buffer strategies. First, the frame buffer can be located either in internal SRAM or external SDRAM. And it supports simple, double, and also partial frame buffer. The partial frame buffer strategy is to not to have a dedicated full frame memory area, but only few lines. And the graphical library is able to use only these few lines to refresh a full screen, doing several passes. But this is done internally in the library. The user only declare the size of the frame buffer that is available, depending on the available RAM, of course, on the chosen MCU. The L8 RGB 565 frame buffer format support is also a way to reduce the size of the frame buffer, because in this case, we do not store 16 bits pixel values, but only 8 bits values. These 8 bit values are then indexes that are used to retrieve the actual values of the pixel in the lookup table. And the current 2D acceleration use Chrome art IP, which is included in several ST MCUs, for color filling operation, bitmap blitting operations in RGB 16 bits, 24 bits, and even 32 bits. And also the A4 and 8.8 pixel format that are lookup table format used for text. And both filling and blitting are done with or without alpha blending. So the TouchGFX solution can be split in three main blocks. The first block will be the TouchGFX designer. So what you see is what you get editor with automatic C++ code generation and an embedded PC simulator. Then the TouchGFX engine, which is the actual graphic library, the graphic engine that processes the rendering of each frames, which is composed of efficient algorithm to minimize the number of pixel processing, and makes full use when they are available of the graphic oriented IPs. And finally, the TouchGFX generator, which is the name also of the STM32 CubeMX plugin. So you can find several names for this one. It can be called the Xcube TouchGFX. It can be called also the TouchGFX generator or the TouchGFX plugin. The different name for the same block. And this makes the TouchGFX completely compatible with the ST ecosystem. And it also supports the STM32 Cube IDE, which is the ST proprietary IDE. It's an Eclipse-based IDE, which is comes from the fusion of Atolik and the System Workbench IDEs. In this presentation, we will focus only on the TouchGFX Designer and the TouchGFX Engine. We will review the TouchGFX Generator in a separated presentation on the ST ecosystem for graphic MCUs. First, the TouchGFX Designer. So the Designer is what you see is what you get graphical user interface editor. What does it mean, what you see is what you get? You drag and drop elements, and the C++ code is generated for you for the layout automatically in the background. So it also handles all the image and text conversion into C code, because all the text is first converted into images. Each character that you want to use in your demo on your layout will be converted into a glyph. A glyph is an image representation of a character. And all this image needs to be converted into a C table to be used and stored on the board. And even if the C++ code is automatically generated regarding the layout, the source code can, of course, and must most of the time, be manually extended and customized. This is the difference between the generated folder you will see in the demo versus the graphical user interface folder. The generated one is a read-only set of files, and the graphical user interface is the user part. And the user part usually inherits from the classes from the generated folder, and that's where you put your own logic for given elements and all the elements that are not supported in the designer, because everything cannot be done within the designer. You have to extend the code that you generated outside the designer. And the TouchGFX Designer also manages an Excel sheet for all the text strings that are referenced in the application. That's also where you can find all the multi-language support. And it's sometimes easier to directly edit this Excel sheet to sometimes maybe import automatically a new language in an automatic way. And it's an all-in-one standalone solution for ST development kits. That means that almost all the ST development kits, meaning the discovery kits and evaluation board, are supported through application templates. An application template is all the required configuration of a given ST development kit to initialize the required element for the graphical application. All these are known for the ST development kits, and so application templates contains all this configuration already pre-made to be used directly in the designer. And there is also a toolchain embedded in the designer that allows to open to create from an application template your a prototype of a graphical interface layout, build it within the designer, and even program it through the Cube Programmer. But it's transparent as soon as the Cube Programmer is installed on your PC, so you can create the graphical interface, build it, and flash it. All this from the Touche Fx Designer. It also enables a fast design iteration thanks to the PC simulator, because the flashing of the on the board can be quite long. You can then do first some debugging on the PC simulator to see if you are satisfied with your graphical interface behavior, and then once you're done, flash it finally on the board. It includes a multi-screen application and some ready-to-use widgets, skins. So you have dark skins, light skins. So it's a set of widgets that have the same appearance, and also supports the definition of interactions. We will see what interaction means. It's usually a trigger, so the click of the button, an action which would be changed to another screen, and this interaction can also be programmed within the designer. And it has also a custom container creation tools, which is interesting for a specific set of widgets that needs to be repeated on several screens. We will see also later in the presentation. In terms of IDE, the IR IDE is supported by all application templates. Some also support Keel, and the target is that all the application template are migrated, so that the IDE will be the supported IDE will be the one supported by CubeMX. We will come back to this later. The PC Simulator toolchain use minimal graph GNU for Windows GCC toolchain, and is also provided with a Visual Studio project, so you can debug the PC Simulator version of your graphical user interface within the Visual Studio project. The TouchFX Designer can also be used in command line. That means that all the buttons that are present in the designer, so the run target, generate code, and flash run simulator, can be launched from a command line tool that could be useful in some specific development task automatization. So the canvas is the main editor screen of the TouchFX Designer. So in the middle, you have the actual screen that is currently edited. The left part of the window is the list of all the widgets that are available in the editor. The second tab gives you all the screens that are already defined with the contained the widget that are inside them. So here it's a demo that is available in the TouchFX Designer, which is called the pull control. It has two screens, and you can control the light of the pool and the temperature of the pool. The last tab is for the custom container. We will see on next slide how it works. On the right side of the screen, you can see here all the attributes that are of the selected graphical element. So here you can see the name, the location, and the image that are associated to it. So the widgets are quite numerous. You have some basic shapes widget. The box, for example, are mainly used to define the background of screen. You can have some simple lines, some circles, some shape. Also a set of button widgets with or without text, and completely flexible ones. And this list of widgets, of course, evolves at each TouchFX Designer release. So this is the status of the 4.13 0 version in the next version that there should be more widgets available. So you have also some images widget, some animated widget, some progress indicator also, and some predefined containers. So you have several types of containers, some to perform some scroll list, some scroll wheel, which is the same as scroll list, but with a wheel effect. So it's the here you have the selection that moves from up to down or left to right. In this case, here the selection is always in the middle. But keep in mind that all these widgets are provided in source code in the TouchGFX installation folder. So if you want to tune the specific behavior of a widget, it's possible. And you have also some clock widget and of course a text area, which is necessary to define any type of text. Regarding a custom widget, could be the use of a custom container? So in this custom container creation tool, you can, for example, here I defined a set of three buttons. So it's a next, previous, and a validate that would appear on each of my screens. That can make sense for in some application. And I would then not redefine at each screen my three buttons. I will define a custom container that I will include in each of my screen. And know that when you define a custom container here, this name will appear then in the list of widgets as an available widget. To extend the existing widgets, you can use and you must use the C++ inheritance feature. As I said, the widgets are all provided in source code. So if you want to customize one widget, you can just implement in C++ all your specific behavior. And more widgets, example, are available on the GitHub repository. It's called TouchGFX Open Repository. In there, you can find several kinds of widgets, or graph, for example, or the carousel widget. It's an example of the implementation of a specific of custom widgets that can be a base for your own. The interactions can be also set within the designer tool and fully set in designer tool. So interaction is a trigger first. A trigger can be a button click or another interaction has been completed, for example. An action is an act on a widget. So hide a widget, show a widget, go to next screen. But it can also be call this source code, this C code. In this case, if you call a function, for example, it will create the function body, but you will have, of course, to provide the actual implementation of the function, where you will put your own behavior. In this case, this interaction will not be fully set up in the designer. Part of it will have to be done in your external IDE. And if you use this checkbox, you can trigger another interaction. All this, in fact, you already covered normally if you did the very first hands-on on the TouchGFX designer. The custom behavior is then edited in the designer using your preferred IDE. The designer also provides an image management panel. In this panel, you can see all the images that are imported in your demo, in your layout. And with for each the color format, for example, here you can select the image format. By default, it will be the same as the application, but it can be reduced using a lookup table format, for example. But then you will reduce, of course, also the number of colors that could be displayed. So it has to be used with care. The text management panel is the place where you can import any type of tool type font. So here it's a Verdana font, which is imported with various size. And you can also limit the character set. For example, this font is used for the temperature display. And the temperature display is dependent on the temperature sensor, which is only retrieved at runtime. But you still have to say, okay, I need to display this character for the temperature, and the character would be only a numerical character from 0 to 9. So that's where here you say, okay, for this specific font that is used for temperature, you will transform into glyphs the number 0 to 9 from the Verdana police in a size of 45. And in this way, you will not retrieve the entire Verdana police, convert the entire Verdana police, all the characters, but only the one that we will use for the temperature. And for the holder, you take only the, if you have a text area written, where is written the temperature, you will only take the letters, the characters of the temperature word, and convert them into glyphs. That's done automatically. Here you specify the range, the possible value of this text area. And you can also here add some languages. Here it's there is only a Great Britain language, but clicking on this button, it will add a new column here with the translation of each zone of text that is defined in the layout. Finally, the designer also shows a project configuration panel in which you can set some specific. I will not review all the possibilities because they are not all relevant at first. But first, here in the build section, you can see all the commands that are launched when you click the Run Target button or the Run Simulator button, which is quite interesting if you want to customize the way you launch the build. If you want to use, for example, another makefile, you can here specify that. When compiling for the simulator or for the target, I want to use a different makefile for a test, for example, or maybe for with a different acceleration. And this is also the place where you define the default image configuration. If you want all the images you added to be in a lookup table format, so on 8 bits, then you will set here the image format to L8 RGB 888. But of course, as we saw in the image panel, it can be set individually for each images. The TouchFX framework. The TouchFX solution relies on the Model View Presenter software design pattern. This is a modern way of doing user interface development, just like iOS, Android, and the like. It's a structured way to separate the code into classes, making coding much more efficient in terms of reuse, maintenance, and code quality. The idea is to separate the graphical user interface logic and the layout. So the communication with the system hardware is separated from logic and graphics. And it's easy to develop and test independently. If you define a command interface that says that when this button is clicked, then the temperature must be retrieved from the system, then you do not have to actually retrieve this temperature, but just say, okay, I will call the getTemperature function. And for the testing, the user interface testing, it can be done without the actual board. So it's a way to separate the hardware implementation from the graphical user interface layout setup. It allows to a lot of reuse of code. So what is a TouchFX application? A TouchFX application is a set of screens, several screens, and each screen is composed of a group of widgets. And this group of widgets will be the view of our Model View Presenter design pattern. And their logic is then represented by the presenter. So we have the group of widgets, which is the view, what is seen on the display, and the logic behind. I click this button, it must switch to another screen. This logic is handled by the presenter. And there is only one screen active at a time for lower memory usage. So if you define 10 screens in your design in the TouchFX designer, the memory usage will represent only the worst case of your screens. So it will never you will never get any surprise at all time. The memory consumption is fixed by the heavier screen of your layout. So the event flow from the model and view to the presenter. So if something happens on the back end, then the model is notified and it does not update the view directly. It first tells the presenter, the active presenter, that something happened on the system. And then the presenter, depending on the current active screen status, will notify the view to refresh a part of the display, or to hide a widget, or to act on the view. So the same applies on the other way. When something happens on the view, so a user interaction, for example, it does not act directly on the model. It just goes first to the presenter that will decide, that will process the event and update accordingly the model and the view also, because something happening on the view can update the view directly. And the model is the only interface with the hardware and the backend application. So regarding the model, there is only one model in a given application. It's what is called a singleton. So you have only one instance of the model, and it stores the states of non-active screens. That means that if you have some data, some counter, some variable that needs to be shared between all the screens, their value will be stored in the model necessarily, because it's the only instance that is available in all the time life of the application. A given screen, screen and view pair will only be instantiated when active. Otherwise, all the memory related to this pair of classes, the presenter and the view, will be freed. So it's the interface with the hardware, it's relaying events to and from it, and it has a pointer to the active presenter. The view, as we saw, is holds and configures a widget of the screen, of one screen, the active one, and it has a pointer to its associated presenter to relay events that happen on the screen. And the presenter receives the events from both model and view and decide which action to take. Talking about terminology, IntelliJFX, but not only, it's the same terminology in almost every graphical user interface approaches. A drawable is the basic UI user interface element. So it has some basic attributes such as the position, the size, is it visible or not. So these are the attributes that are shared by any element that is drawn on the display. The widgets inherits from this drawable class, so we are talking about classes here, and can thus be drawn in the frame buffer. Being a drawable is the only way to be drawn on the screen. So for example, an image, a text area, a box, they are all drawables, but an image has more attributes than a simple drawable. It has a link to a table of that contains a pixel of the image that needs to be refreshed. So in this case, when drawing an image, we'll have to get this position, its size, but also get all the pixels that needs to be redrawn to redraw the widget. And the containers are not drawable. They are a collection of widgets and of containers also. But they are not drawn themselves, but the children are. So you can draw a container, but when you draw a container, you will in fact ask to draw all the widgets it contains. And the children are then positioned within the container. And the TouchFX also introduced some mixins features that it's the way to associate a specific behavior to drawables. So you can turn an image into a clickable image. By default, buttons are clickable, but images are not clickable. But you can add a click listener to an image and to any drawable, in fact. And there is also a fade animator that can that allows to set up a fading effect to a drawable, move animator, draggable. So all these mixins It's just to introduce the idea, the terminology of mixins. That is a way to add a behavior to a specific variable. And then we will quickly go to this hardware abstraction layer notion, because we will go in details on this point in the ecosystem presentation. It's a set of high-level interfaces that connects the TouchFX library to the system. So the TouchFX library doesn't know to which screen it is connected, doesn't know how to handle a touch panel, for example, but there is a set of functions that must be provided to it so that it can work with it. So if we take the example of a touch panel, the TouchFX library expect to retrieve the position of the last touched area from a sample function. So it will use internally this sample function, and this sample function will have to be implemented by the user depending on which touch screen is connected to the library. So this is valid also for the operating system. As I said previously, the TouchFX library needs some locking mechanism, such as a semaphore. So it relies on a generic interface, but this lock function is up to the user to be implemented. And it's the same for the HAL hardware abstraction layer, which is a more complex one. But the most important function of this one is a function called flush frame buffer, and it's the way that the current frame buffer will be actually transmitted to the display. And this function is specific to the chosen display and the chosen interface. So there are default implementation, which are usually empty implementation, and then we will fill it for it's automatically filled when using an application template, because we know which display is connected to a given development kit. If you use the CubeMX, as we see in the ecosystem presentation, you have to provide this implementation, because the CubeMX cannot know which display is connected to your MCU. So there is also a frame buffer locator, which is used for a partial frame buffer, but will not. I just mention it so that you can keep in mind that these kind of interfaces are defined, but as a first step, it will not be mandatory for you. Same for the LCD controller and touch controller that I mentioned before, and the physical button controller also. It defines a set of elementary functions required to handle physical button controller. Then up to you to implement this function properly. So that's a general overview of an application implementation. So the core part is automatically generated, and is the set of interfaces I just mentioned. So you can see here the presenter, the screen, and each screen is in, each view inherits from a screen. And here you can see the drawable that from which the button inherits, and from which your custom drawable will inherits also. And the model is automatically defined on the user side, and can be updated directly by the user. This will not be updated. These are base classes that will not be updated by the user. And finally, we will go quickly into the TouchFX engine. So the TouchFX engine is delivered as binary. It's really the core of the TouchFX library. So it's delivered a binary. The main reason is because it must not be modified. If we let customer modify this, it could lead to unexpected result in the general behavior of the library. So it's better to keep this as binary. So it's responsible for the frame rendering. Takes into account to determine exactly which element must be redrawn by with occlusion culling algorithm. So the occlusion culling is the way to determine which objects are visible or not, depending on other objects. If part of the background image is covered by the button, then this covered part will not need to be read, to be refreshed, because it's hidden by an object. And the dirty region determination is another algorithm that will define, depending on the life of the user interface, if do you have an animated image, for example, only the area that contains this moving image will be updated. The rest will be kept as is in the frame buffer and sent as is to the display. The frame buffer management is also done, especially for the partial frame buffer, by the TouchFX engine. So it's the TouchFX engine that is responsible to split the rendering of a frame into several passes if the frame buffer is not a full frame. And the TouchFX engine also structured to make full use of the STM32 hardware accelerator when they are present. So the Chromart, the JPEG codec, and even the floating point unit when it's present. It can run with or without real-time operating system, given that you provide the lock mechanism that are mandatory to work. And as we will see in the next slide, it has a low footprint and especially a deterministic dynamic memory allocation. Yes, there are some dynamic memory allocation, but it is within a specific range of memory. As I said, the TouchFX generator, the TouchFX designer generates some code and generate a memory consumption given the worst case of all the screens that have been defined. So it will define a block of memory that will be reserved for dynamic memory allocation, but it will be fixed at compilation time. It will not be it cannot be bigger at runtime. So an overview of what is needed for a graphical application. So you have on one side the RAM, so it can be internal or external, and the flash. So the flash are for all the data that must be retained, for example, all the input bitmaps, the core library itself, and the application, all the instructions of the application. On the RAM, they are used only at runtime, and once the board is shut down, it's lost. So the minimal size is 20 kilobytes for the flash usage. That's for the TouchFX framework. It cannot be less, in fact, given the size of the current library. And on the RAM size, it can go from 10 to 20 kilobytes, depending on the task size that has been defined when using FreeRTOS, and of course, depending on the data structures that are used in your application. Regarding the application itself, it can go from 1 to 200 kilobytes of flash usage for the screen definition and the graphical user interface logic. And for the RAM, it goes from 1 to 15 kilobytes for the part of the widget that are dynamically allocated. And the biggest part is for the application side, for the input bitmaps and glyphs and all the text that is defined. This can go from 1 to 20 megabytes and even more, depending on the complexity of your user interface. That's why usually some external flash is mandatory for most of the graphical user interface. If you have very simple ones, you can even go without external flash at all, because you do not need any input bitmap. You can only do some colored buttons. In this case, there is no bitmap required. And the frame buffer on the RAM side is also, if you use a single or double buffering, I'm not talking about partial frame buffer, you need a full screen. So it's for a WQVGA display in 16 bits, it means 480 by 272 pixels multiplied by 2 bytes. So it means, and multiplied then by 2 for double buffering. So it's 500 kilobytes that are fixed on the SDRAM. So also, except on the H7B that we use in this workshop, that has a 2 megabytes internal RAM, usually some external RAM is external SDRAM is needed for the frame buffer storage. So all these application, the green boxes, are highly application dependent. If you have only one screen, you will be for sure at the lowest end of the range, but you can go even above the maximum, which is only an indication here. You can go above quite quickly with several screens and a lot of widgets. That's the end of this presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.